Okay. Okay, yeah, welcome to this talk about Philippe Flageolet. So the first thing I notice is that the date here is the one when the talk was supposed to take place, actually, and not today. But anyway, so Philippe Flageolet, so he's a French computer scientist, mathematician, and he was born in Lyon in 48 and died in 2011 in Paris. So 3 years, 4 years ago. And well, a reason why I decided to talk about Philippe Flageolet is I did myself my PhD in Paris at that time. So in 2011, I was in Paris. And so I noticed like people started talking about the death of Philippe Flageolet, and it had actually a very big impact in the whole French community, research community. So from my own perspective, I encountered Flageolet always only in, well, so he's working in algorithms, randomized algorithms, and it was one of these guys that we used to cite in our area, like a really old paper of Flageolet in the 80s, 85, and this was kind of the beginning of a whole area. And for me, this was just this one big paper somewhere in the past, and I didn't know much about Flageolet, actually. So preparing this talk was, made me understand much more about the personality of Philippe Flageolet. So there's also a reason why I put a map here. So on the map, you can see Lyon and you can see Paris in France. So just keep that in mind where that approximately is. Okay, so on his webpage, Philippe Flageolet has this quite catchy writing. So does research, smokes, battles administration, smokes, wishes he could stop battling administration so that he could have more time to do research, smokes some more, gives jobs to starving foreigners, eats occasionally. And that's essentially the first thing he actually puts on his webpage as a description of himself. And I find that actually quite a good good description, since, well, first of all, he's a researcher. So we start with does research. He smokes indeed fine. Then the fact that he battles administration kind of shows already that he's not someone who's just conveying to the system. He just really, he really tries to do something against this problem. Then he smokes some more, fine. And well, then again, this whole line goes back to battling administration. So he really, really tried to do something against that. And well, he smokes again. So smoking is here some quite dominant theme. Right, so so there is a guy called Luc Devroy, and he must be a friend of Philippe Flageolet. He's a Belgian researcher who's right now working in Canada, in Montreal. And he was pretty shocked, I guess, about the moment when Philippe Flageolet passed away, and he wrote the following about him. And I know it's a lot of text, but I think it's absolutely worth reading it. The image that is etched in my mind is that of Philippe Flageolet happily purring while listening to a great exposition by one of his students or colleagues. At the first opportunity, he would shout something funny in the direction of the speaker to show his appreciation. He was the community's cheerleader. The inside of his car has never been cleaned, his hair camouflaged a biological experiment. His shirts were always untucked, and yet wherever we went, he was inevitably surrounded by friends and followers, admired for his brilliance and wit, and revered for his guidance and generosity. And he continues, he was a master of mathematical illustration. He likes to show that craft in his passionate talks, which grew more intense with every tick of the clock to end up in overtime. On one occasion, I saw the last button of his shirt pop off just before the final slide. He started wearing Indian style of his belt in the last decade of his life to avoid such events. One of his other passions was listening. His seminar series in Versailles was legendary. It was an honor to be invited. And Philip listened, purred, teased, shouted, applauded, and acted up. Anything short of throwing a paper airplane at the speaker with a heart drawn on its wings. He was the glue that kept the community together. So it's quite a very good description, I guess, of Philippe Flageolet. So on March 22nd in 2011, when he passed away, so Luc, he really expressed himself about well, this loss that the French community had. And yeah, he wrote that, "I do not care about the world today. Philippe Flageolet died this afternoon. My heart is in the gutter." So it's very, yeah, it's a big loss. Yeah, maybe it's almost too negative to read all these these statements aloud. So we might just pass on to the next one. So here we have Robert Sedgwick, who was a collaborator of Philippe Flageolet, a very close collaborator. And they wrote, "Well, the world has lost a brilliant and productive mathematician. Philippe's untimely passing means that many things may never be known. But his legacy is a coterie of followers passionately devoted to Philippe and his mathematics who will carry on. Our conferences will include a toast to Philippe. Our research will build upon his work. Our papers will include the inscription dedicated to the memory of Philippe Flageolet. And we will teach generations to come. Dear friend, we miss you so very much, but rest assured that your spirit will live on in our work." So, yeah. So one last thing that I found quite moving, actually. So Philippe Flageolet, he worked in a team, the ALGO team at INRIA, French Research Institute. And well, that is the statement that you can read right now on their webpage, actually. "So our band, which was so merry, is now extremely sad and remained voiceless for a lot of time. But we cannot forget our beloved Pifu. And his eternally renewed interest for algorithmics, mathematics, and Indo-European linguistics, his taste for good wine and good food, his constant humor." And yeah, I guess at INRIA in France, they have a painting, which is down there, actually, somewhere on the wall, which is the village of Flageolet. And in the center, this should be Philippe Flageolet, I guess. And they call him the algorithmics, like, which is quite nice. And last, I was also quite surprised to see, so a member of this former ALGO team, he's working now in a different team, and that's kind of a screenshot of his webpage, and he still essentially writes, like in the last paragraph, about yeah this passing, that about the death of Philippe Flageolet, and he's called the fearless leader who tragically disappeared. And yeah, I found it quite moving that people definitely still 4 or 5 years now after his death, they do really care a lot about that. Right. I think another fact that made the story, this passing away of Philippe Flageolet, quite sad is that so he died by a cancer, and he apparently was very well for a very long time. And suddenly, like his health degraded, and a couple of weeks later, he actually passed away. So it was quite extreme. Okay, but to get back to a better atmosphere, maybe I show a couple of photos of Philippe Flageolet. So he was, I think he was a joker. He was, yeah, he was making fun of other people. He didn't mind when other people made fun of him, and. So that's, yeah, here he really does enjoy some nice bottles of wine, I guess, and has a good time. Okay, but maybe let's talk a bit more about science, a little bit more. So so he was born in Lyon, he went to school in Lyon. And yeah, in 68, he went to École Polytechnique in Paris to do his undergrads and actually also, I guess, his master degree. And so I said, you should look at the map in the very beginning. Here's another map. So he was born in Lyon, he moved to Paris, and he went to École Polytechnique, which is down there. So it's in the kind of in the 20 kilometers south of Paris, just to keep that in mind. Afterwards, somehow, after the École Polytechnique, he immediately went to INRIA in Roquencourt, which is another place, which is here in the west of Paris, so also some 20, 30 kilometers west of Paris. And so he was recruited by Maurice Niva, who was also his PhD advisor then. And what I find just very curious is that if you look at the dates here, which I can't really explain how this happened, but he was at École Polytechnique probably as a master student till 71, but he got his PhD degree in 72. Which appears to be a bit short, right? So either I don't know how this happened, actually. In any case, Maurice Niva immediately recruited him from Ecole Polytechnique as a researcher, probably without a PhD, to work in this at INRIA in this research center, which is, I think, quite extraordinary that he didn't even hold yet a PhD and was recruited. And what is quite also surprising is that, well, that's it. He stayed at INRIA in this team for his whole life. So, in 76, they founded the Algo Group in which he worked. And in 81, then he was the head of the Algo Group. But I find it just really remarkable, like when we think about, Magnus talked, for instance, about Leslie Lampert, and Leslie Lampert abandoned his PhD in the second year, didn't like engineering, thought about starting a musical career, moved from A to B, traveled a lot. And Philippe Flagellet, actually, if you looked at the map, what I showed, he stayed in France, he grew up in Lyon, he went to Paris and stayed in the area around Paris for all his life. So this is quite, I think, quite remarkable for such a big researcher, actually. Right. So he worked and lived in this area around Paris at INRIA Rocconcourt. So this is kind of Philippe Flagellet's PhD advisor was Maurice Niva, whose advisor was Marcel-Paul Schützenberger. And this is this line of really great French mathematicians and computer scientists. They are all kind of related, they learned from each other. And I know that Philippe Flagellet worked also in the beginning with Schützenberger, so he had a really good influence for his work. Probably you, Luca, you know much more about these people than I do, I guess, but you can definitely see that these are the big names of the French.
When you can look at the PhD descendants of Maurice Niva and Schützenberger, you get basically the gamut of the whole of theoretical computer science in France.
Exactly, yeah.
If you find someone who does super theoretical computer science work, who is not a student of one of these guys.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's look a little bit about what he actually did in his research. So it can be described as a happy marriage between combinatorics and analysis applied to computer science and discrete mathematics. He's known as being the founder, you could almost say, of analytic combinatorics. Like he wrote a book about this topic together with Robert Sedgwick, and they both these were definitely the most important people in this area. And I didn't know much about analytic combinatorics. I will later give a little bit an idea of about what that is. And this is then applied to the analysis of algorithms. And for another reason, he was very interested in symbolic computation that I will also mention how that, where that came from.
Mention the size of this book, Analytic Combinatorics. I think it's
900 pages. It's 900 pages and it's actually extremely difficult to read. It's, that's true. And somehow Philippe Flagellet, I don't know why he had his book in his hands, but I like this. It's just like this photo. Right. So as I said, an important person was Robert Sedgwick in his life. And so, I watched a YouTube video done by Robert Sedgwick. So he gave a presentation, an introduction to what actually analytic combinatorics is. And he told a very nice story that I want to tell. So Robert Sedgwick, he has a paper, this first paper, data movement and odd even merging. And it's what he does is it's a counting problem, and he comes up with a formula that looks in this paper that looks something like this. It has the gamma function, the zeta function in it, and it was quite a surprising maybe result. In any case, he went to Providence in Rhode Island to this Fox conference, and Philippe Flagellet had this paper on the average number of registers required for evaluating arithmetic expressions at this conference. And he also had a formula in his paper that also has the gamma function, the zeta function is a bit different, but still kind of similar. And apparently, so at this conference they met, and what Philippe Flagellet said was, "I believe that we have a formula in common." And right? And well, Robert Sedgwick said that that was essentially the beginning of their collaboration, and it took them their whole life essentially to figure out why they have this formula in common. And somehow he also said they don't really know why they have it in common, but who knows? Yeah. Okay. Right. Okay. Let's go on to analytic combinatorics to see a little bit what it is. So the idea behind is that you have a combinatorial object, a combinatorial configuration, and you try to figure out some properties about this structure, but using methods from analysis. And I'm going to give the example that is actually in Philip Flageolet's book, the one that is so hard to read, as a motivation for why, for this whole field of research. So, yeah, well, the first example. It's the beginning of the book. And yeah, I read it, and on page 3, I thought, wait, that's harder than I thought. So the introduction is actually quite difficult to read. In how many ways can we lay n items on a table in a row? So we all know the answer. It's quite easy. It's just n factorial. And well, we also have the Stirling formula, right? So we can kind of approximate quite well how much the factorial function actually is. And that's actually already quite an interesting thing that involves analysis. There's the e is included in this function. There's pi included. But still, we are arguing about a finite combinatorial structure. So it's not really obvious to see why this is. And yeah, also an interesting fact is actually that the factorial function is not that old, actually. It was so in this in this book from Donald Knuth, The Art of Computer Programming, he tries to trace back actually where the factorial function first came from, or where it appeared first. And well, it's not that long ago. It's 500 BC, which is probably a bit surprising that it took so long to kind of capture what it means that you have n times n minus 1 times n minus 2, that it's actually as long as n, who knows. In any case, let's look at the next question. So how many alternating permutations are there? So essentially what we want to have the numbers from 1 to, here we have 9, and we want them so order so that the first one is smaller than the second, but the second one is then larger than the third, and so on, that it's essentially alternating. And that's already not that trivial to figure out how many are there, actually. So there are that many compared to the factorial function. Like if we have a length of 7, for instance, the factorial is really large, but the alternating permutations, they don't grow as quickly. They do grow quite quickly, but not as quickly. And the question is how can we figure that out? So what's interesting about it is, so here, for instance, if you look at this sequence, in 1881, like if you look at the Taylor expansion of the Tan function, then you can see that essentially the coefficients before each term, like if we disregard about the factorial that is always included in each element of the sum, then these are exactly the numbers that we have, that we are looking for. So this type of using a generating function, that's called a generating function here, and arguing about the generating function is quite the central object actually in analytic combinatorics. And well, so how can we now figure out how many elements there are? We simply could, for instance, compute the coefficients of the Taylor expansion of the Tang function. And well, I mentioned before, Flageolet was interested in symbolic computation. This is one of the reasons why. So he tried to optimize symbolic computation for that. But what is even more challenging and interesting, where actually his field, he has a lot of results on, is actually we want to get a closed formula for these coefficients. We don't want to compute the Taylor expansion, like the coefficients of the Taylor expansion one by one, but we want a closed formula. And this is then where essentially the analysis comes in. So an approach how this is done is essentially that they kind of approximate the Tangens function where it has its singularities, because at this area it has some properties that will be exploited. And this can be somehow approximated by a simple function. And from this function on, then you can somehow better deduce these coefficients. In any case, well, this it becomes very complicated. But what is quite impressive here is that the estimation you get by such an approach is very, very good, actually. There are very, very good approximations that you get in this way. And Philippe Flageolet is, I think, yeah, he's quite well known for working with generating functions, arguing with generating functions, and yeah, that's his main area. So the nice thing about analytic combinatorics is that it has many more applications than I first thought of. So he was interested in, well, in sorting algorithms even. And he looked in, for patterns in trees, factorization of integers and polynomials on finite fields, things like the birthday paradox, queuing theory. And now two things that I want to talk a little bit more about. This is this probabilistic counting and the number of distinct elements, which is, yeah, which touches on what I'm more interested in research. So I like these topics a lot, actually. So here's a problem. Suppose we do something like data streaming, a streaming algorithm. A streaming algorithm would be like here on the left side. We have some input, and we are only allowed to look actually on, from the input from left to right. We go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 and so on. And well, that's it. So we are looking for an algorithm that accesses the input in that way. So for instance, suppose we want to read whatever, the totality of Shakespeare's work. We just read the book one by one. So we a book we read from left to right, right? So this fits in the setting. And in the end, we want to output how many words actually have we seen in the book. Or for instance, how many different words have we seen in the book? Clearly, our memory is limited when we read the book, so we can't really remember everything when as we go along with the book. So it's actually not that obvious how to do these things. So let's, yeah, right. Streaming algorithms is nowadays is a very active research area because we have massive data sets, huge data sets, and they just don't fit into a small random access memory. So we can't really store the huge data sets anymore and access them arbitrarily. So yeah, we have to kind of go through them maybe once from left to right, but we already forget what was in the beginning while we work on the end. And yeah, I like for streaming, I like this idea quite a lot. Like it says, if you look into a stream and you just see things passing by, but yeah, at some point you forget what was in the beginning. So I think that's the, it's a good idea to think about streaming algorithms. So for instance, suppose we have now a stream and just items come in one by one. And in the end, all we want to know how many items are there. Then of course, that's quite obvious. We just use a counter. So we count from 1 to n. We need log n bits to store the counter, and that's good. But the question is, can we actually count with less than log n bits? So that was the big question here. And actually, we can count approximately. So what about, suppose we count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on the first line, but we only store an exponent, so that 2 to the k, we store this exponent, would be approximately the number we want to count to. So for instance, right, if yeah, if we have the number 7, for instance, then 7 is included between 4 and 8. So we could, for instance, simply store the number 2, because 2 to the 2 would be 4, which is within a factor of 2 to the 8. So that would be the goal, just to count and only use basically the exponent of such a representation. And the good thing is, this only requires log n bits, because the number itself requires log n bits, and the exponent would then only require log n bits. So the goal is to count in such a small space. And there was actually an algorithm proposed in 77 by Robert Morris from Bell Labs, and he did the following. So essentially, in the beginning, we start at this node, and then we flip a coin. As soon as we see an item that we want to count, we flip a coin. With probability 1/2, we just stay in this state. With probability 1/2, we go to the next state. Then, again, we flip a coin, but now with probability 3/4, we stay in that state. And with a probability 1/4, we move on. Because, well, in the beginning, we have to increase our counter quite a lot, but then we stay a long, long time with this exponent until we have to increase again, so we stay even longer. So the probabilities have to change. And yeah, it was a very difficult work actually to analyze this algorithm. It sounds so, looks so trivial, but the combinatorial structure of this algorithm, like if you try to compute the expectation, where actually do we end up, or what's the variance of this algorithm, is very hard to analyze. And yeah, the first full analysis was precisely done by Flageolet using analytic combinatorics. And these type of results, even nowadays, like this paper from 85 with Flageolet and Martin, is cited in many, many papers in streaming algorithms as like one of the very first papers that worked on streaming algorithms. So one application of this is, for instance, what he did is he wanted to count the number of distinct words that are used by Shakespeare in the totality of his work. So, I mean, what would be a trivial approach? We just take a data structure. We, as soon as we see a word that we haven't seen before, we kind of store a bit whether that we saw this word or we store the word itself. In any case, the memory we require for doing that would be, well, at least linear in the number of words we see, right? So Shakespeare had actually, if we look down there, it was 28,239 distinct words. So that would mean we need a memory at least of that many bits if we want to do it precisely. And yeah, with this technique of kind of approximate counting, and actually for the number of distinct words, the algorithm is even more complicated, but he managed to count that in, well, 128 bytes in total. So actually what I wrote down here is essentially a memory screen, screenshot essentially of that is used in this algorithm. So it's kind of really small, like really small. So that is right. Okay. This problem, number of distinct words, is a very important problem, and is researched very well. So that was this paper in 1985 from Flageolet and Martin. And I just like the story of this problem. The question was, how small can the memory actually become for such an algorithm? How little information do you have to store? And the problem essentially was resolved in 2010, like in 2010 by Woodruff and Kane and Nellen, and I think it's Nelson. I think there's an S missing, yeah. And right, so they matched the lower bounds. They could prove optimality of this algorithm, but it shows that initiated by Flageolet in 85, this is very, very early for this type of research. And then there was a long break until 1997, until like new results really came up concerning this problem. So he definitely was a pioneer in this area. Okay, then let's talk about some distinctions that he got. So he got the CNRS Silver Medal. That is, the CNRS is kind of the center research, Centre National de Recherche Scientifique in France. And they give every year one gold medal to a researcher that is a researcher in France, and 15 silver medals. So he was among those that received the silver medal in 2004. He's a member of the Academy of des Sciences. He is a member of the European Academy of Sciences, and he has an honorary doctorate degree from Brussels University. Then he got the Knight of the Legion of Honor, which probably you have to be French to really understand what that means. So I also don't really understand it too well, but the requirements is a minimum of 20 years of public service or 25 years of professional activity and some special merits. So the flawless performance of one's trade, as well as doing more than ordinarily expected, such as being creative and contributing to the growth of others. So there are only overall 75,000 knights. So it's basically the beginning of this hierarchy. And when I saw that, I was wondering who's actually the Grandmaster, because there's only one. And the Grandmaster is actually Hollande, the president of France, and it's always the president of, so he, as soon as we have a new president in France, then this will be the Grandmaster. There are many other distinctions. There was a special issue in Algorithmica in the journal for his 50th birthday. Later there was, for his 60th birthday, special issues in discrete mathematics and theoretical computer science. One of his papers was listed as one of the most influential papers since 71. Yeah, and what I noticed was when he passed away afterwards, there were many, many seminar series in Paris that were dedicated to his name. And yeah, I found also the last fact quite interesting. So he's very interested in linguistics and in Sanskrit. And yeah, his wife donated then 2,000 books that he had to a library in Paris and one in Versailles. Okay, then finally, for those who are interested, he has a quite small Knuth number, Erdős number, Weyl's number, and Einstein number. And I want to end this presentation with a slide, actually, that I copied from one of his presentation, and that's that one. That's it.
Well, we have time for questions. Well, about the counting algorithm for Shakespeare's book, can you go to that slide?
Sure.
Afterwards, repeat the question for all the people on YouTube who are listening.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I missed it. You mentioned how little memory is required, but what about the degree of approximation?
The degree of approximation, I'm not sure, but nowadays these algorithms give you a 1 plus epsilon approximation for an arbitrary epsilon. So you get very, very close. I don't know how it is in this particular case, actually, like which approximation you were expecting to get with these 128 bytes for what he counted here. But basically, why I use this example is because, well, 128 bytes, if you multiply by 8, you see that he used 1,024 bits. And the number of words is much larger than that. So it's definitely a sublinear algorithm. Mm. So the question was essentially which approximation factor we get for the number of distinct words here. Mm. Sure.
So it's 1 plus epsilon approximation. For any epsilon is the result by Kane, Nelson, and Woodruff?
Yeah, they proved that this is the best. Well, it was Woodruff presented an algorithm that matches all existing lower bounds. There are many lower bounds of the type that say if you want to get a 1 plus epsilon approximation, you need at least a function, for instance, of 1 over epsilon squared times something else. But this algorithm matches precisely these lower bounds, actually, and also has an update time. So as soon as you read an item, you only spend a constant number of operations on updating your memory state. So this algorithm is essentially optimal in both senses, like it uses the minimal space and also the computation time is as small as it could get. Yeah.
And this is one of, because you're interested, this is one of the contributions for which David Woodruff got the received the Press Booker Award, the Young Scientist Award of the European Association for Theoretical Computer Science last year.
Yeah.
He's scary young researcher. Well, scary in the sense that
very productive.
Very productive. Very productive. He has already produced research that is sufficient for several academic careers.
Any more questions? Do you have any idea of how many PhD students Flageolet had?
Because so you worked all his life at UVA Rocancourt, that's a research institution. So
I think he
had less of an opportunity to have PhD students than if you were at the university.
I'm actually not sure how many PhD students he had. They're like, on the web, you can find about 3 PhD students, but I'm not sure whether this is essentially it. But yeah, I listed them here. So for these 3, we can be sure. But yeah. Maybe.
And we had many more, all worth mentioning. So, for instance, Gerard Berry, the guy who's coming here in August, he was also a PhD student of Moliniva.
So, okay. just a subtree here, it's not the complete picture.
Very small subtree.
Yeah.
Okay, but you can take more questions offline, as they always say. Thank you very much to Christian for.
Introducing us to Philippe Flageolet. And I hope you will come to the